Hi, good morning, good day, wherever you are. It's Monday, 6th of August, 2018. Like every business day, welcome to Real Time Daily Trading Ideas. We have 5 days a week, five different traders. We will speak about trading ideas, strategies, and market screen, and maybe one or two questions from your side directly answered in our webinar. Our goal is quick and smart, so let's have a nice start like every day. And like every day, we will start with our business disclaimer. Forex and CFDs are leveraged products and can result in losses which exceed your deposits, but only if you are a professional client. Because since August 2018, the new ESMA regulation is effective in the whole European Union. If you are a retail client, the maximum loss is your account balance. So from 2018, from August, now it's important also to know about the two classifications of clients, retail client or professional clients. More about that you can find on our webpage, admiralmarkets.com, for example. If you'd like to read the full disclaimer, just visit one of our web pages. Like I said, for example, at admiralmarkets.com, and you will find everything written down there. Also, the kits, the key information documents, if you'd like to read them. More information also, like I said, about retail clients, professional clients from now is important to know about it. Professional clients will get an additional protection at us called negative balance protection policy up to 50,000 British pounds. Yeah, like said, ESMA, one of the topics of the year for all traders in the European Union. If you trade DAX or Eurodollar before, your margin requirements was much lower as a retail client, and now the new margin requirements is to see here in the two pictures. If you have questions about that, just contact your local customer support and you will get all answers about all your questions about the new ESMA regulation. This is me. My name is Jens. My English made in Germany, so I'm the German guy, but I'm not the main speaker for the webinar here today. The main speaker is our day trader of today. This is our scheme. On Monday, like today, it's Jay's day. On Tuesday, it's Paul's day. On Wednesday, it's Giancarlo's day. On Thursday, Marco's day. On Friday, it's Dirk's day. Our leading day traders live every business day to the same time. And of course, if you like to trade Forex and CFDs, you will get many benefits only with us. For example, DAX 30 or also Eurodollar, triple the spread to the main trading hours, just 0.8 points or pips without any additional commission. Check it out on admiralmarkets.com, and there you'll find also something about our regulatory background and how to contact us. You can call us, you can send us an email. But now enough from my side. Now it's time for Jay. Good morning, good day, Jay. You had a great holiday. Now you're back. What's your view to the markets today?
Good morning to you, Jens, and good morning, traders. I'm happy to be back. Had a wonderful time back in home in the States, and now we're off to the races again. A lot of volatility in the market, great headlines, and volatility means that we're able to make some money. So great that you're all back here. Thank you for showing up. Let's head right into the markets. Headlines overnight, we had a risk picture that was quite mixed at the morning. We had the equity markets, i.e. stocks in Asia. They initially turned green. We had a very good close on Friday out of the Wall Street. We had non-farms, but unfortunately, limited upside. Why? Because US and China trade war are in full effect. None of the two sides are backing down. And really, what's happening is that the Trump administration is trying sincerely to hit the Chinese where their weakest Achilles heel is, their weakest spot is. And that is a highly, highly leveraged financial system that all you have to do is, in order to keep them occupied with their own problems, is to have a monetary stable expanding economy, as in the US, with a central bank that's hiking rates. And then you have policy divergence, we call that. We have US rates rising. If you look at, especially for my traders in the room, the 5-year real yield, it's still rising. So the DXY, the DXY, the dollar index is still lagging that line. So as long as the real yields in the belly, the 5-year, keep rising, we can expect further strength in the US dollar based on that. So we have the Fed hiking, and we have China and the People's Bank of China initially being preoccupied in cleaning up their shadow banking system. And that's out the window right now because they need to increase domestic demand and stabilize their system by adding liquidity. And their biggest fear is that their capital controls need to be reinstated and increased as they did in 2015. So Google 2015, what happened in China, and then you will see that their fear is for hard currency to leave the country. And that also means keep an eye on Bitcoin. There may be sincere flows leaving China that way via going into cryptocurrencies like, for example, Bitcoin. But this is not a Bitcoin webinar. We're still talking about the major currencies, the G8 over here. But the name of the game currently is the yield differential between China and the U.S. And it's not the short yield in the China has come off. So, and the dollar yield is increasing. So that means that shorting China doesn't cost us any money right now. I mean, it will us as retail traders, because the retail brokers will not pass the entire cost savings to us on. But for the institutional client, having on a short renminbi trade is versus the US dollar is not a carry negative right now. So that's significant. So we saw overnight last Friday, the People's Bank of China said that shorting the renminbi via forwards and options is becoming more expensive. They reignited a rule that in 2015, they took the cost from 20% down to 0% in terms of margin requirements. Last Friday, they reversed that. And the key, and that's why I included this chart for you all, the key is the 7. Dollar renminbi, if the offshore yuan goes to 7, the central bank of China needs to intervene again heavily. So it's very, very interesting. That needs to be your major focus right now, is that chart. Okay, UK Trade Secretary, different input now, puts the odds of leaving the EU without a deal at 60-40. So on the back of that, we saw this morning market opening up and the pound experiencing weakness. Then we had what I call bullshit news, excuse my French. We had Saudi Arabia dispelling the ambassador of Canada within 24 hours. They need to leave, the entire envoy. They're really upset because Canada's Prime Minister Trudeau called them out on women's rights. You know, okay, so they get really upset about that. And Bahrain is siding with Saudi Arabia, blah, blah, blah. How much trade is really going on? Actually, you can go online and you can look at the numbers. It's a few billion dollars, $640 million Canadian so far this year. Yes, there are some relations, but not strong enough and deep enough to really consistently weaken the Canadian dollar. Okay, and we have some numbers this year. And then the other chart that I always want you to keep an eye on is the US 10-year. We had James Dimon, he's the CEO of JP Morgan. He came on tape over the weekend and he said, expect 10-year yields at 5%. We have the largest short treasury positioning in the market by spec money in years. So the crowd is never right. I don't see the 5%. I continue for now to see 3, 3.10 as a barrier for 10-year to rise, and then demand will come in and lock it in. But I may be wrong, and we'll keep it on the radar for every week now. Okay, this was an old trade. The strength versus weakness this morning we see here in the last 8 hours, how the pound weakness came in. And then the Canadian dollar recovering. Interesting, because a lot of analyst reports that I read over the weekend are quite bullish on the Canadian dollar, and positioning yields the same expectation. Okay, let's have a look at the important numbers and announcements and econ news headlines for the coming week. We have the RBA statement. We'll talk about that in a second. It's expected to come in at unchanged. For pound, we only have the Halifax HPI coming in, expected a little bit lower. Then on Wednesday, we have inflation expectations out of New Zealand. We need to keep an eye on inflation expectations across the globe. Very important for us if inflation really starts kicking in. I'm not that hopeful, but we'll keep an eye on it. And then we have the official cash rate out of New Zealand, also expected to be left unchanged at 175. And then on Thursday, we have inflation numbers out of China at 2% versus 1.9 expected. We have producer price index, i.e. another inflation component out of the US, not 2 versus not 3 last time, and core not 3 unchanged versus last time. And then, of course, we have the unemployment claims. And then on Friday, important for us, we have the monetary policy statement out of the RBA. That is always of interest to us to see if they're changing their expectations in terms of economic growth and inflation expectations, and also in terms of the trade war. Because as long as the renminbi keeps weakening, the Aussie dollar will have significant headwinds and will be unable to really strengthen. If I look across the board real quick, I wanted to share with you two trades that came in this morning by large investment banks. I just need to find it real quick. One was short Aussie yen. I wanted to give you the targets. Yeah. Morgan Stanley was recommending shorting the Aussie yen at market, which at the time was 82 spot 30, with a target of 79, the figure, and a stop behind at 83.30. And then we had Citigroup, and they recommended to sell cable, i.e. dollar, GBP USD, British pound versus US dollar, called cable, at 129.86, with a target of 127, the figure. The figure is always 0.0, okay? And a stop behind at 131.5. I recommend you take a look at the option expiries and see if that makes sense, especially in cable. I'm sure Andreas, our trader, is already on it. I'm going to back up. Let's see, Wednesday, Thursday. Here we go. GDP on Friday. I wanted to allude that real quick. That's also important because the Bank of England will want to see if the weakness in Q1 that we also saw in the Eurozone was actually a one-off, and if GDP growth and expansion is back on track again once more. Here you can see not four versus not two. Comes to mind the Q2 GDP growth in the US while I was on vacation. I hope Jens talked about that to you guys. Came in at 4.1. There were some bullshit figures floating around ahead of the news with regards to 5% expansion. That was, of course, bogus. 4.1 came in very strong and in line, but here too, we had a lot of businesses getting their product and shipments out before tariffs were hitting them. So we had an increased economic activity due to negative tariffs being imposed. And that's why we don't expect Q3 and Q4 GDP readings in the US as strong. So keep that in the back of your mind, please, because a lot of the headlines that I read were very, very positive. You always need to go into the numbers and make sure that you understand what is the key driver, why a number is good or bad. And then we have CPI and core CPI on Friday out of the US. So real quick, German factory orders out of Germany came in much worse than expected, not very good for the euro. And then the Centex investor confidence came at 14.7. And once more, and I'm happy to repeat all these standard things for you guys so that you really start remembering them and recalling them on your own. If a business cycle turns, one of the key things that needs to turn for you to understand that the business cycle is turning ahead of equities coming off, meaning selling off, is investor confidence. And it's still very high in the Eurozone. So we're good to go for that indicator for now. Tuesday, RBA rate decision, as I said, expected to be unchanged, but a dovish tilt. For those of you, dovish means lower rates, in this case for longer. Hawkish means higher rates. Yeah, and the central bank determines the short end of the curve, except in Japan, they also determine the 10-year yield. They call that yield curve control. YCC is the abbreviation for that. Dovish, why? Because of the global trade tension and a slide in Chinese activity indicators. And that also means as long as the Chinese economic activity indicators are sliding and the currency is coming off and the rates are dropping, that means the Aussie dollar will have severe problems rising. German industrial production on Tuesday and the US JOLTS. As always, a prelude to the non-farms and to the labor market data. Wednesday, we have China trade balance. That will be of interest, obviously, due to what's going on in the market right now. And then on Thursday, we have the RBNZ. Again, expected to keep their rates unchanged at 175. And currently, the market is pricing in a 60% probability that their next rate hike is in Q4 2019. So who can tell me when is the next rate hike expected for the euro? Who knows? Jörg, Eugen, Andrea, who can tell me What is the market exactly? September 19, third quarter, late, early fourth quarter, late third quarter 2019. Thank you guys. So my traders always know which central bank, what is the expected increase or decrease? What is the next step in terms of a central bank's move, monetary policy? If you don't know that, then you don't know why a currency strengthens or weakens on the back of economic numbers, because every central bank has one to two economic factors or indicators that they really focus on. And if those indicators then come differently from what's expected, the currency will react accordingly. That is why Forex trading is so easy. It's nothing to do with charts. It has everything to do with what are the central banks looking at. And if that number comes better or worse than expected, you make your money. So you don't trade often, at least not on the bank side or on the prop desk side, but you trade in line with what the central bank is focusing on. So the RBNZ may raise its inflation view in its latest projections due to rising crude prices. Okay, fine. But in terms of economic numbers, we saw soft GDP growth, we saw weak business confidence, and we saw rising jobless metrics, and those were all posing downside risks. And I remember before I went on vacation, one of the gentlemen in here, complicated name, he said he was very, very bearish on New Zealand dollar. And I had to agree with him. That was quite a good comment. Thank you for that. China on Thursday, CPI numbers, that'll be of importance, as I said. And then US PPI. PPI is producer price index. So what goes into the value chain? Obviously, if you produce something and your input cost rises, what do you do as a business? You pass them on to your customers, as long as the price increase doesn't ruin your business. Eventually, everyone hits a point, like $1,000 for an iPhone. Apple found out that that's the limit. Global consumers do not want to pay more than that price point. It's an auction. Everything that we do is an auction process, and the price rises until the last buyer gets shut out. It's very simple. Trap buyer, we call them. So CPI and PPI in the US is expected to rise, not 3, as we saw early on, and that takes the year-on-year rate to 3.4. Recall that the Fed said they're absolutely fine for the time being with inflation running a little hotter than usual, than what their usual price target is or inflation target is in their band, okay? So don't worry if inflation numbers are coming in pretty high right now. Currently, market is expecting 2 more hikes for this year. And again, that will put a lot of pressure on the Chinese economy. And we have the Central Bank of India, who recently, last month, I remember before I went on vacation, asked the Fed to potentially slow down a little bit, because as the reserve currency of the world, a US dollar that is getting more and more expensive is putting more and more pressure on emerging market countries and economies, naturally. So if you want to look for a short opportunity outside of Forex, I mean, then look for emerging market countries who have a lot of debt load, especially in hard currency, as in US dollar, because as the yields in the US are rising, especially the variable debt part, that cost will rise for an economy that has to pay back in hard currency their debt, i.e. in US dollars. Okay. And then on Thursday, we have US and Japan holding bilateral trade talks. And on Friday, that finishes off our week, then we have Japanese GDP and Canadian labor market data. And out of the UK, we have the GDP for the second quarter, and it's expected to show a rebound from the earlier alluded to soft first quarter print of 0.2, and expected to come in at 0.4% year on year, month on month, and this year on year is set to come in at 1.3 versus 1.2. If that is the case, then the Bank of England will sigh a breath of release, because they're looking for further vindication that the soft growth was transitory in Q1. And on Friday, we have the CPI headline, and that's expected to increase to 0.2, and that keeps the year-on-year figure at 2.9. So recall 3.4 on the PPI year-on-year and 2.9, both numbers higher than the 2% target by the Fed, both numbers okay to be running hot for the time being. question is, how many rate hikes will be happening next year in the US? That's already where the market is, what the market is concerned about. So the core measure is expected to remain steady at 2.3 for the core. And then some analysts expect an upside surprise, the number coming in at 3% and not 2.9. Why? Because we had a very low read in June in terms of cost for shelter, i.e. rent. But that may be countered by gasoline prices, which rose by 1% in the month of July. Interesting, right? What we all look at. But that is the name of our game. So let's look at some positioning data. That's always a lot of fun and gives us great signals. Aussie dollar continues to be on its way to a long signal. The long signal hasn't been confirmed yet. And what do we keep an eye on? Just a little refresher. What do we keep an eye on? Why is the Aussie dollar not rising right now? Anyone? Are you guys sleeping? Are you still listening? China, excellent. China, i.e. trade war. And trade war. Thank you, Lovro. Trade war, thank you, Andrea. China, and especially the dollar strength. Very good point, York. We need to see the next chapter, so to speak. Yeah. China is really in a bad spot. I mean, some of us don't believe that. I have problems believing that, but they're really in a bad positioning. Their system is so highly levered up, and there's so much credit expansion there. Trump is really screwing them right now. It's not good. Canadian dollar, we have a long bias. Swiss franc, we have a long bias. And New Zealand dollar is also on its way to a long signal. But that's just the positioning out of the CFTC. In terms of volatility, we see euro rising a little bit. Pound, that for sure is going to rise today. Oh, someone's calling me. Anyhow, yen is decreasing. That alludes to that points us to a trending market. And then the VIX is coming off as well. We see US equities really, really strong right now. Option pricing, bullish. Nothing bullish out of the OTC option pricing this morning. But bearish, we have euro dollar, dollar yen, euro Swissie. And gold. Jörg, are you still short gold? He's our gold trader. Option flows. This morning, we have a bullish signal or bullish bias for the Canadian dollar, for yen, and for gold. And then we have a bearish bias for Aussie dollar, pound, and euro. Today, nothing. Okay, good. Yeah, it's also a little bottom edgy, so keep an eye on it. If the DXY is coming off right now, it's at 95.29. If the DXY is coming off, the gold long may actually work. Let's go one slide back. You see that we have gold out of the option flows as a bullish indication this morning. So bottom edges, depending on what the dollar is doing, might actually work. Anyhow, I would like to look at short pound versus yen. I don't want to jump on the let's all everyone, my grandmother and her dog, short the Aussie dollar right now. Because the positioning is getting a little extreme. Again, recall the herd is never right. So if everyone and their grandmother is short Aussie dollar, why do I need to jump on the bandwagon now? I should have been short a long time ago and not now. Doesn't mean that the trade doesn't work that Morgan Stanley has recommended. I don't mean that at all. It could just be a consolidation and then it continues the second leg lower. I just don't like being the last guy in a trade. I hate that. So GJ is a momentum trade at the moment. So we already breaking towards session lows. So I need a little hook and then a continued go. Why is it breaking lower? That has only to do with the Brexit risk at the moment and that's coming through on the headlines. And on the yen side, I hate that the yen is not really behaving like a normal currency because it has deteriorated to such a risk on risk off currency over the recent years, which is sad. But in terms of yen yields, we need to be aware and recall that last week, the Bank of Japan said that they are allowing the 10-year yield, which they kept at 0.10%, that they allow it to rise all the way to 0.2% before intervening. They intervened last week, and you need to keep that on the radar, because right now what's happening in the market is this. Listen carefully, please. 10-year Japanese yields rise, London opens, Bund yields rise, New York opens, Treasury yields rise. So it's an amazing chain that Japanese yields at the moment have such an effect on European and US yields. On the other hand, we have hedging costs for large Japanese long-term investors, read insurance companies, for example. They used to take their yen, exchange them into euros and US dollars, and then they bought German government bonds, French government bonds, Spanish government bonds, US government bonds. But since the yields are rising back home now, the hedging costs are increasing for them. So it makes almost no more sense if the yields keep rising a little bit further, especially in the 30-year bucket, Japanese insurance companies no longer need to buy French, German, and US investments in terms of government bonds, 10-year spot on the curve. So those flows will actually revert. That will put additional pressure on bunds and on treasuries. And maybe US treasuries will then break the 3.10 in terms of yields and rise. And that's what James Diamond also alluded to over the weekend. And or the German Bund will actually continue to rise. So keep an eye on A, Chinese yields, and B, Japanese 10-year spot and 30-year spot on the curve, please. All right. Sorry that I put so much wording today without slides. I need to get back into the groove. Sorry for that, guys. But I hope you're listening and you can take some information out of it. So risk on sentiment obviously is risk factor for the trade short pound versus yen, and or if the economic numbers completely outperform, flows would go back into the pound, and that is also a potential risk factor. So there's a chart. What do I want to do? This is what we call a break. We broke the low of yesterday, or from Friday, excuse me, and there's also always what we call liquidity, i.e. limit orders waiting there to happen, institutional money. The question is always, what do they, whoever they are, the ominous market, what are they doing with the liquidity? And what they're doing currently is they're selling the liquidity. So I need it to bounce back maybe to 144.50 area, yeah, which is a confluence to the swing low, i.e. the low of Friday. I need it to bounce back, or maybe it's going to bounce back to the point of control a little bit higher. And there I expect resistance, and then it's going to tank. Sorry, and then there's a probability that the market may continue lower, and my target is 143.75, which comes all the way from a weekly chart. Let me check how we are on time. 28 minutes, okay. 28 minutes.
Yeah, time is always our limit, so I guess we have 1 or 2 minutes more, but then we have to find the end. I will already say now, thank you for today. Tomorrow is another day. We have 5 days a week, 5 different traders, so join us every day with a different trading style. If you'd like to see and view this again, a couple of hours later, it will be available on our YouTube channel. And yeah, greetings from Berlin office. Bye-bye. And the last 1 or 2 minutes, bye, Jay, from now.
Okay, thank you. Real quick, I just wanted to show the traders that we are at a potential bounce point at the moment. But like I said, on the 1 hour chart, if you break it down to the 1 hour chart, they've used the liquidity to sell it off, but we're hitting a potential target. But my expectation is that we may go a little bit lower. So this is really what I want to see. I want to see something like this. Yeah, and not short at the bottom. That makes no sense. I need to see a bound, like the break, the hook, and then the go. And again, the target for me is 143.75. And the short starts for me either at the low, which is 144.50. 143.75, so that's 75 pips, great. And then your swing above, a couple of swings higher in terms of risk reversal right here, that's where our stop needs to be. So I expect that this POC will hold, point of control. Makes sense? Hopefully it makes sense. Otherwise, we have another Monday next Monday, and we can go back into the charts a little bit further. Guys, thank you very much for showing up. great to be back with you. I'm super excited to make a lot of money. Thanks for your time, and trade smart, live free. I'll catch you all next Monday. Bye-bye. Jens, thank you. Bye.